So it's a great pleasure to have Johannes with us, and he's going to speak about spin chains to real-time thermal field theory using tensor networks. And initially, he will start with a general introduction, and then he will talk about his work. And he's from my institute, Max Planck Institute for Gravity. He's working in the Gravity Quantum Field Information Group, and he's collaborating with the people that is shown in the first slide. And here he is working with Michael Heller, who is his supervisor. So Johannes, you can start your talk.
Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction, and hello everyone online. So I have attended personally a lot of online talks, but now it's actually the first time I'm actually giving an online talk via Zoom. So, okay. As announced, I want to introduce you to your tensor networks, which I want to demonstrate that these tools that come from a quantum information perspective can be used to extract thermal quantum field theory results from simple spin chain setups. And this is work done in collaboration with Viktor Svensson and Michael Heller from our institute, as well as Marie-Carmen Bernoulz and Carl Janssen, who are working in lattice gauge theory and tensor networks, respectively. So we are here at the Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics. And as Sayantan said, maybe or only a few persons of the, in the audience might be familiar with tensor networks. So I will introduce to you also some general properties what tensor networks represent, and yeah, feel free to always ask questions. Okay, so what is the general background for this work? So the basic problem or interest is to understand the dynamics of quantum many-body systems, which is an important problem not only in condensed matter but also in high-energy physics. In particular, in high energy physics, which is mostly our community, the most prominent example are heavy ion collisions, which are which probe phases of the quantum chromodynamics matter. And in particular, one wants to understand the relaxation from a very non-equilibrium phase to the quark gluon plasma, which exists in such quark gluonic matter. On the other hand, in the context of condensed matter physics, quantum many-body dynamics is also an important problem, in particular the understanding of the importance and meaning of integrability in the context of the thermalization and relaxation processes is very important. And also in this context, more tensor network studies provide a way to gain insights into such strongly coupled systems. And as I already introduced, I want to use tensor networks. And I will introduce tensor networks as a representation of quantum many-body states, so wave functions, in a particular tensor product basis. And the key property is that such tensor networks capture some relevant entanglement properties, and therefore allow also efficient time simulations, which motivates us to explore thermal quenches of the one-dimensional idling spin chain with the aim to extract real-time quantum field theory dynamics, so not just finite size properties. And we also want to make very non-trivial predictions about some interacting quantum field theories. So overall, one can say that in this project, several directions join together. So on the one hand, in the context of lattice gauge theory, tensor networks can be seen as an implementation of, or can allow a particular implementation of tensor networks. That is one way to see these tensor network states. On the other hand, the thermalization and relaxation properties are also important in the context of hydrodynamics. And furthermore, we also want to study meson states. These are non-perturbative bound states that are also very important in quantum chromodynamics. So if people in the audience are familiar with this research direction, then such topics will also play a role in this tensor network study. And last but not least, if we study critical systems, then there might exist also a gauge gravity dual on the gravitational side, so that some of our results can be also dually studied in the gauge gravity context.
I have a question, Johannes.
Yes.
Like you talked about the thermalization, how it helps to study the thermalization phenomena particularly?
So the important feature is that tensor networks allow us real-time simulations of quantum states. Mm-hmm. So we can see if some thermal states, as we I will show, relax or thermalize to some equilibrium value if one does some perturbation of this thermal state, for example. The overall restriction is that we are so far limited to 1+1 dimensional systems. So in one spatial direction, but real-time dynamics for this system, at least in this study. And since tensor network allow these real-time simulations, we can also ask questions related to thermalization and relaxation.
Okay. So anybody have any other question then, up to this point? His motivation?
Yes, always.
If anybody have any question related to his motivation, please ask. Unmute yourself and then ask.
Yeah, always simply ask questions. Okay. Having that said, let me jump directly to the main quantity that we are interested in this project. And in particular, we want to use linear response theory as a starting point to actually study the real-time dynamics of quantum many-body systems. And the basic quantity, namely the linear response of some local operator O, is defined as the convolution of a Sewell's term J with respect to some retarded two-point function. G, R, O, as it is called here, is the retarded two-point function, or sometimes also called Green's function.
And what do you mean by delta of the expectation value? Is it...
That is a small perturbation, or that is the linear response for some small perturbation or source J, which might be some time-dependent field, whose time evolution is governed by a source Hamiltonian H.
Okay.
And this retarded two-point function we are interested in is calculated at some finite temperature T, which is simply mm-hmm. 1 over beta in our definitions.
Mm-hmm.
And by general properties or...
And this rho beta is your thermal density matrix.
Yes, so this retarded two-point function GR can be calculated as a thermal expectation value, which is this trace rho beta and then the commutator of O, the operator, at retarded arguments Tx and so to say T tilde, X tilde, we choose to be zero.
I have a question. So this T is greater than zero?
So we have a Heaviside theta function in this definition, so that T or in our definition, the perturbation would happen at time zero, and we consider for T greater than zero our calculation of the retarded two-point function.
The trace operation you did with respect to which state?
Thermal state, we have a thermal state at some rho beta, some finite temperature, and we take which we can see as an operator, and we take the trace of this.
Is it kind of a thermophile double type of state or something else?
No, we don't need to think in terms of TFD states. It's simply like, I can in the tensor network language that I will introduce to you, we can see that as an operator.
Ah, okay.
And yeah. Similarly, then we take or consider the commutator of our or the operator, the quantum field theory operator that we are interested in, that is called O here at retarded arguments.
Okay.
Yeah, right. And we are interested in
structure. Another question, why you just only consider the retarded part of the Green's function? Why not the advanced? That means full Feynman Green's function.
The full what Green's function?
Because like you have written the retarded Green's function in terms of a Heaviside function. So there is another contribution, which is the advanced Green's function. Probably you know.
So we are only interested in this retarded two-point function, so which means that we do a...
That's what I'm asking, that why you are interested in the retarded Green's function for this calculation.
Well, this retarded two-point function governs... let me first say that we want to consider this quantity in Fourier space, such that the time response is governed by the structure of this retarded two-point function in the complex frequency plane. So that means that poles or singularities, but also branch cuts, govern the time evolution of our quenched quantum many-body system. So we have in mind that at time zero, some perturbation happens, and we want to ask how at advanced or later times this correlation with this perturbation acts on our system.
Okay.
In this sense, we are interested in this retarded two-point function only where perturbation happens at time zero.
Okay,
that is the basic quantity, and the quantum many-body model that we are considering might be familiar to a lot of people. It's the well-known Ising model, and it is defined by this Hamiltonian for a system of n spin one half spin or chain of n spin one half spins. It contains a nearest neighbor interaction term defined in terms of the Pauli matrix sigma z, then a transverse term parameterized by h, and a longitudinal term parameterized by g. And with respect to the sigma z Pauli matrix,
it is a two-dimensionalizing model.
So we are only in one dimension. So it's a one-dimensional Ising spin chain. But since we then consider the time evolution, we can see it as a, or as I will soon say, it will be given by the two-dimensional Ising CFT.
Okay. But what is the J and H and Z?
So J is setting our overall units. It's will be technically set to one, and H and G sometimes would be called the transverse, and H the transverse and G the longitudinal field strength, or sometimes also magnetic field strength. So it's simply parameters that govern the perturbation in these directions.
Okay.
And the corresponding phase diagram is shown in this plot here. Independence of the longitudinal and transverse field. And it is well known that when the for the transverse field H equals J, which will be set to one, then one has a quantum phase transition at this quantum critical point. That means that there is a phase transition from a ferromagnetic.
One corresponds to the value of H.
H is 1 under the condition that we also overall set the unit J to 1.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. And this means that we have a phase transition from a ferromagnetic, so an ordered phase, to a disordered phase.
Okay.
Which is
what kind of phase transition it is? First order or second order?
Not sure if it makes, if one can think in these terms. would guess a first order. No, but no, critical should be second order. I think second order is an easy thing, but I'm not totally sure.
What is the order parameter of this phase transition?
A possible order parameter would be, for example, the longitudinal magnetization that drops to zero at this point with an infinite slope that could be an order parameter.
Okay.
And what is relevant that at this critical point, one can take a continuum limit that I will elaborate a bit later. And at the critical point, the correlation length diverges so that one can get rid of all lattice effects such that in the continuum one has a quantum field description in the infrared regime, which is the Ising CFT, which might be probably also known to people.
So this conformal field theory is in which dimension? One dimension?
That then would be the two-dimensional.
Two-dimensional quantum field theory. And what is the E8 theory?
Let me first. I will discuss it and then ask.
Okay.
So one has the Ising CFT at the critical point in the continuum limit, and one also has the possibility to map this Ising model to a free fermion theory, as long as the longitudinal field vanishes. So on this horizontal axis in this plot. And this means on this axis, the model is integrable. So before I come to E8, let me mention that in the continuum limit, one has Ising quantum field theory Hamiltonian that is the continuous representation of this lattice Ising model in the continuum limit.
And is the usual fermion.
Yes.
Dirac fermion.
It's a Majorana fermion.
It's a Majorana fermion? Okay.
Yes.
But then why this Schieber? Majorana fermion?
Let me first describe. I want to discuss that now. So at first, taking the continuum limit means that the lattice spacing goes to zero, which is the inverse of our unit J. Additionally, one has to take the size. So this should be n, the number of spins should go to infinity. And similarly, one wants to excite only IR degrees of freedom such that beta times J should be much bigger than one. And then under this continuum limit, the Ising quantum field theory is given by this Hamiltonian. It contains a kinetic term for Majorana fermion. Psi bar psi perturbation parameterized by mh, which is something like the mass in transverse direction, which is proportional to the transverse field in our lattice description. And one has a term proportional to mg, which is the something like the mass parameter in the longitudinal direction, which is related to some power of the longitudinal field G in the lattice description. And there are two fields, psi, and of course then also psi bar, and sigma, which would be the continuous representation of our spin field in longitudinal direction. And for this quantum field theory, there's some relevant cases, namely,
hello, Johannes. Hello, Johannes.
Is he at the AI? He must be So can you please go and tell him that the microphone is not working?
Yeah. Okay. Probably it's a problem with his end.
Yeah, yeah. Just run and go and tell him. Thanks.
Okay, so you can see my slide. Very good. Okay, I don't know. There must be an unstable connection. But anyway, I was just introducing the icing CFT at the critical point in the continuum description, which is a C=1/2 conformal field theory. Epsilon and sigma are scalar primary operators, which would be proportional to the transverse and longitudinal field, respectively, in our lattice description. That is for the special case that both masses are zero. If only the transverse mass MH is non-zero, one has a massive free fermion quantum field theory. This would correspond to being on this horizontal axis that I mentioned previously. On the other hand, if one has, and this one is integrable. Similarly, if one has only a longitudinal perturbation, so when only mg is non-zero, one has an interacting integrable quantum field theory, which is known as the E8 quantum field theory by Tsamolotchikov. And there, Tsamolotchikov calculated that there are 8 massive and stable fermionic bound states that I will sometimes or then also will call mesons. And we are particularly interested in studying the last case when both masses MH and M0 and MG are non-zero. Then one has an interacting quantum field theory that is non-integrable and which may contain stable but also unstable bound states, or in other words, mesons. So this is the most interesting case. And our tensor network study that I will present is actually able of studying this quantum field theory and make predictions in this very complicated regime of this originally very basic icing model that we all learn in undergrad studies. But still in the continuum limit, one has a very rich quantum field theory description for this model. Okay, so are there questions regarding this?
Yeah. So I want to ask that this number 8, is it related to the fermion doubling problem in lattice VCD?
So I only can say that this is a special leak group or E8, but I'm really not an expert in this particular analytic properties. I don't really think that this is related to a doubling problem, because that is should be more property of this leak group, but it's only a guess. I cannot for sure say.
And how do you know that when you are setting these masses to be zero, this particular kind of QFT you are going to get?
For which mass to be zero?
So like you are saying when MH is zero and MG is not zero, you are getting E8 QFT. And for the other case, you are getting free fermion QFT. How do you know this? Can you like sort of explain this?
So in the when only MH is non-zero, we are on this axis. We can map this to equation and annihilation operators by some Bogoliubov transformation, which I will call a mapping to free fermions. This can be studied as integrable and can be studied analytically, and this simply can be done and is also well known. But then with the work of Tsamolotchikov, one knows also that there is a quantum field theory description for this purely longitudinal direction across from this critical point. So longitudinal perturbation from the icing CFT, which then turns out to be also integrable. which, however, doesn't mean that it is in any way easy to actually study it. It's a very complicated interacting field, really, but still it it's an integrable theory.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, of course. Okay, if this is now discussed, then I actually want to introduce our main tool, which are tensor networks. And as an overall theme, one might say that tensor networks are a classical simulation for a quantum problem, and in particular a quantum many-body problem. Because what is a general property is that the Hilbert state of any arbitrary quantum state is very huge. So if you have the many-body wave function with respect to some basis, I call in, I1 to in, then one has d to the n coefficients all these complex numbers in the sum over all basis vectors. And here the in might run from 1 to d, where I call d the physical dimension. That would be simply 2 in the case of a spin 1/2 system, so simply up and down, so that we have 2 to the n states, for example, which is an exponentially large Hilbert space, which in fact cannot be studied analytically. However, tensor networks provide a way to actually reduce the size of relevant states in this huge Hilbert space. And basic observation is that ground states of local gap Hamiltonians satisfy an area law for the entanglement entropy. That means for a for a system of spatial dimension L, the entanglement property is proportional to the L to the power d minus 1.
I have a question here. So what do you mean by local gapped Hamiltonian?
So gapped, so there's a mass gap, and it must act locally. So in the language of our spin chain, Hamiltonian would mean, for example, that it acts on, for example, nearest neighboring sites, or any definition that referring to some particular spatial or the local spatial dependence.
Okay.
Yeah, so that is the general area law, and a particular tensor network called matrix product states are ansätze for the many-body wave function that implement this area law. And there the basic definition is in this expression here. One again wants to represent the many-body wave function psi in some basis I1 to IN. And as coefficients, one has a product of matrices A1 to AN. Here the index I1 up to IN is our physical dimension or our physical index, which again might run from 1 to 2 only for our spin up down system. And for every fixed value of I1 and up to IN, these matrix or A1 to AN are matrices of dimension chi times chi, where chi is called the bond dimension. And so the coefficients in this ansatz for this wave function can be also graphically represented in exactly this way as it is shown here. Namely, one every blue blob represents a matrix A1 up to AN with the physical index I1 and so on. And this line, these horizontal lines, mean a contraction over the bond dimension chi, that is the size of every matrix A. And That means that we have overall capital M times small d times chi squared parameters, which is only polynomially much, so we can actually efficiently represent our wave function. So overall, that means that from our huge many-body Hilbert states, we have reduced our ansatz to an exponentially small corner in this huge Hilbert space, which, however, represents very efficiently Arianor states, which we are actually interested in for our Hamiltonian picture that we are considering.
Excuse me, I have one question.
Of course.
So what makes the, I mean, there are several representation of the tensor network. So what makes the matrix product state suitable for this kind of problem? I mean, we can like other representation like entangled, projected entangled pair state, the pairs are, I mean, there are several others, but what makes this representation the most suitable one?
Yeah, that's a very good observation. We have also other tensor networks. So let me then actually show a picture. So you're just called the tensor network. So PEPS tensor network is actually a two-dimensional extension of such a matrix product state. So if in the future one wants to consider also two-dimensional spatial systems, then one would have to choose PEPS tensor networks, which however we of course want to start with one-dimensional systems. So then simply it reduces to matrix product states.
So actually these are kind of extensions. These are kind of extension of this work, like we can also do this kind of problem for other kind of, for in other dimensions using this kind of representations.
One could use the PEPS tensor network. The very strict constraint is that it is computationally very hard. Because of the scaling of the independence on the bond dimension, it is not just chi squared, but it would be the bond dimension to the power 2, but instead the bond dimension to the power of at least 6, maybe up to 10. So it would be computationally extremely costly.
Okay. So it's due to mainly the computational problem, I mean, like, okay.
Exactly. There are already works in this direction, even for real-time evolution of two-dimensional systems, but of course only for very short times, and in principle that is a very interesting topic, but so far we of course want to start with the most reliable one-dimensional systems.
Thank you.
Yeah, and as this question already also highlights that we choose our bond dimension as a parameter, might be at the order of a few hundred computationally, and this actually sets the size of how many states we capture in our many-body Hilbert space. So maybe especially for those of you who are very new to the this topic, let me give some basic notation in this tensor network setup, namely a simple number would be graphically represented by a simple blob, for example, and then every index would be represented by a line. So if we have a vector, we would have a circle with a line. Similarly, a matrix has two indices, and it can be generalized to any arbitrary rank n tensor. And if we contract something like a matrix with a vector, then we pictorially represent this in the way that we connect the lines between different tensors, which here would be simply mean doing the contract or multiplication of a matrix with a vector.
So Johannes,
yes,
I just have a question that for this rank n tensor, so computationally what's the maximum value of n people have reached?
So it's more maybe relevant question is like what is the maximum bond dimension one can take? So for example, in such a tensor network, either one dimensional for matrix product states or for PEPs, and typically a few hundred as the order of magnitude for the bond dimension is a size we use for our real-time simulations. But I guess it might be up to maybe 10,000 in special works, but then not for real-time evolution. So that is, otherwise, if you have a small bond dimension, you can take a large number of for a rank n tensor. That is not so much of a problem as going to high bond dimension to capture the information of the many body state. Yeah, then let me briefly also just mention that there are also, of course, also other types of tensor network states. The MERA tensor network, which stands for multi-scale entanglement renormalization ansatz, is another one, which is particularly suitable for critical states, not necessarily for arbitrary perturbed states we want to consider in our spin chain setup. Okay, so why do we at all choose a tensor network representation? So, well, on the one hand, it allows a very efficient description of our wave function for very large quantum systems. We can easily go to a few hundred spins in our system, but even if we assume or would assume translational invariance, we can mimic also infinite systems. That would be also possible. Another really amazing property is that there is no sign problem. So it has tensor networks have been already applied to study gauge theories and to even QCD with our, at finite chemical potential, but of course with the limitation that we are restricted to one dimensional systems. Furthermore, it allows non-perturbative Hamiltonian studies. And this can be used to study quantum phases. Furthermore, there have been connections to holography in the renormalization group. For logical order and other things can also be studied in this tensor network setup.
I have a question.
Sure.
So there is no sign problem even for fermions?
Exactly. So even with the gauge in the gauge theory, with complicated gauge fields, at QCD Hamiltonian was implemented in one dimensional systems where normally there is design problem, but with tensor networks it is avoided. But or the dream of course would be to write to QCD in 3+1 dimensional systems. That is still in far future, but in principle there is no sign problem because it treats the fermion as the normal wave function.
Okay, even in more dimensions, right?
Even in more dimensions, the complication comes from computational aspects. Doing these contractions, which might scale with a very high power of the bond dimension, and then also maybe implementing these gauge fields is also not that trivial.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, then. Let me continue with another important aspect, which is of course relevant for this particular work, namely doing time evolution with tensor networks, which refers to real time, but also imaginary time evolution. And the basic ingredient is that if we have a nearest neighbor interaction Hamiltonian, so locally it acts on sites I and I plus one, then we do a trotter decomposition. That means that the Hamiltonian in the exponential, which is here shown for imaginary time evolution, e to the minus tau h, is splitted into nearest or into the product of two site gates. And this results in a product of these terms up to some order tau squared, which would be the trotter error for a small increment tau in imaginary time direction. And reshaped, this can be written as the product of all odd sites times the exponential of all even sites, making an error of order tau squared. And this can be also visually then drawn as a tensor network in this way as it is shown in the left-hand side. So these two-side gates represent the e to the minus tau h, or similarly in real-time evolution, e to the minus I tau h, that acts on every matrix in our matrix product states, which is shown in green here, where locally these gates act on sites I and I plus one. And you see I have, in the first row, I have applied it to all what I would call odd sites. So this acts on site one and two, then three and four and so on. And the second line would act on all even sites. So acting on position two and three, what is this, four and five and so on. And in this way, I represent or I can perform real time as well as imaginary time evolution for an arbitrary matrix product state. Similarly, I can act with such a circuit on a matrix product operator, which is a representation of a particular operator in a tensor network, in a tensor product basis. And this means computationally nothing else than adding one more index to the bottom, or having every site has now four indices. So the horizontal are the contraction with our bond dimension. And then to the up and down are our physical indices that implement a particular matrix product operator. And in particular, such a matrix product operator can be used to actually construct thermal states. And this is the overall called the TEBD algorithm, which stands for time evolving block decimation, which is nothing else than implementing this picture that I have described to you, where the thermal state, O0 called here, which would be e to the minus beta h, is splitted up into e to the minus beta half h, acting on the identity, and then multiplied with itself. And that means that I act that with such a blue circuit of my TEBD network on the identity matrix product operator. So the initial red matrix product operator in my picture would be simply a trivial identity. And then I do this imaginary time evolution up to some inverse temperature beta. And similarly, I can do the real-time evolution simply by using unitary gates in the sense of e to the minus tau h, which allows me to, for example, do the real-time evolution of my thermal density matrix, or similarly calculate also thermal expectation values. So if I want to calculate the thermal expectation value of some of the product of some operators O2 and O1, that might be inserted at some spatial positions N1 and N2, then I would act with the time evolution operator U and U decker on this product of operators and calculate it and calculate the trace with the with respect to the thermal density matrix. And such a product is exactly what appears then in our retarded two-point function that we are interested in. Okay, that is like the basic for tensor networks. Are there questions for this kind of background material? Guess not. Okay, very good. Then I now want to come to back to correlation functions, or Green's function, as they are sometimes called. In particular, I want to discuss expectations and results from conformal field theory. And there we are considering one plus one dimensional CFTs, where by simply fixed by conformal symmetry, the result for the retarded two-point function of the operator of given scaling dimension is fixed to be the expression that I show on the top here, simply fixed by conformal symmetry. And the important or interesting property is that this expression in terms of exponential functions has poles, or with other words, singularities at given frequencies, namely minus I times 2 pi t times delta plus 2 n, where I have assumed or neglect in all my future studies the momentum p. So t is the temperature, so we are talking about thermal CFT effects here, and these frequencies lie in the lower complex plane and are proportional to delta plus 2n, where n is a natural number. So we have a set of poles in the lower complex frequency plane for a given operator of scaling dimension delta, where in the case of the Ising CFT that I introduced to you, the scaling dimensions of the epsilon operator would be 1. And similarly, the scaling dimension of the sigma operator would be differ by a factor of 8. So it would be 1 over 8. So that would look like the set of poles that are shown in the picture here. On the purely decaying axis at fixed positions, minus 1, minus 3, minus 5, and so on, if I rescale this complex frequency omega with beta over 2 pi. That is the result of for a 1 plus 1 dimensional CFT. If I then consider also the case of massive free fermions, which would be the continuum limit of the transverse Ising model at zero momentum, then there appear also branch cuts in the complex frequency representation. And in fact, there are two equivalent representations that are shown as red and blue structures in this picture. So let me continue with the red one, that in the case we have also a finite transverse mass MH, one has an additional branch cut between plus and minus 2 MH. And this is the analytic structure with the branch points at plus minus 2 MH. And on top of that, we also have lattice effects, which result in a branch cut where the branch point of this red branch cut are fixed to be at the UV scale, which in our lattice model would be, for example, at some particular value, 8 J minus 2 MH. This is the analytic structure for the massive free fermion case. And actually, so we have branch cuts, and on top of that, our decaying poles, which in fact are related to Matsubara poles, in the lower decaying complex frequency plane. And actually, this representation can be deformed, and then is equivalent to the blue representation in this picture, which is only a branch cut, no decaying poles, with branch points at plus minus 2 MH, but then the branch cut stretches out to the UV scale, where the second branch point is. That are two equivalent representations, and these complex structures govern our relaxation behavior of our quantum many body system, and in particular the lowest decaying pole, in case this red representation is chosen, then this decaying pole sets also our thermalization scale. So what I want to point out with this is that the complex structure of our retarded two-point functions contains the relevant and important properties about the thermalization and relaxation behavior of our quantum many-body system. And thus, we are also interested in actually studying this complex frequency structure. And in particular, for the critical case, where we only have the set of decaying poles, then there is a dual black hole interpretation in the context of the ADS-CFT correspondence, namely these set of decaying poles have been interpreted as a black hole quasi-normal modes in the study by Sachs and collaborators. So that are expectations for the analytically known case. And now we want to do numerical studies with matrix product states. In particular, we want to calculate this retarded two-point function that I already mentioned. And now we have the possibility to insert the transverse or longitudinal field in our spin chain so that we can study corresponding to the CFT either the epsilon or sigma operator. And such a retarded two-point function looks, for example, like in the left picture, where I show at criticality the time dependence of this retarded two-point function for several letters for several values of beta in units of j. And what you see is some decaying and oscillation pattern that actually only represents the UV part of our signal, so which is mainly caused by lattice effects. And what we are interested in is to extract the infrared behavior of this signal, which then would correspond to the quantum field theory contribution in this retarded two-point function. And then in this context, let me point out that we have the transverse or longitudinal field available to choose for our retarded two-point function. And in fact, we always concentrate on the transverse correlation function for the simple reason that the decaying behavior for the longitudinal case is 8 times lower because of the difference in the scaling dimension. And so one would need a way longer time scales to observe something meaningful. So then we are interested in the analytics structure of this retarded two-point function. But let me mention in this context also, which might be more relevant for the condensed matter perspective, then if I convolute this retarded two-point function, for example, with a time-dependent transverse field of my Ising Hamiltonian, I would get, for example, the transverse magnetization of my Ising spin chain. So that would be like one further interpretation of this retarded two-point function. Okay, so our job is that we have such a signal like in the left picture here, and we want to extract complex frequencies. And what we use is a method called PRONI, which is a way of extracting complex frequencies by fitting or representing my signal as a sum of complex exponentials. So if g of t is my signal, I want to fit a sum of coefficients ck times e to the minus omega k times t to my signal. And PRONI is a method that determines the frequencies omega k and coefficients ck independently from each other, which in general might be complex or are by definition complex. And so once the frequencies omega k are determined, one can fit the coefficients ck, or with other words, the residues ck by doing a standard minimal or by doing a standard minimization for my problem. So if I assume that my signal looks, for example, as in this illustration here on the left-hand side, then I want to fit the sum of these complex exponentials to this signal. And what we actually do, we do not choose the whole time window to do this fitting procedure, but we, if for example, as in this picture, my whole time window goes up to 10, I choose a smaller time window and then shift this time window towards later times. And actually, this allows me to study the time dependence of my frequencies omega k and similarly ck, the coefficients, in dependence on the time window, or in other words, in dependence on my time scale of my signal. And this not only allows us to estimate like the stability of the poles or singularities in the complex frequency plane, but actually I can also identify a branch cut by this method. And this is then shown in this slide. So I now apply this Prony method that I just introduced to you to my either analytic or simulation result for the retarded two-point function of the correlator. These are possible results that I get with it. So let's start with the left picture, which is for the critical case. So we describe the Ising CFT itself. What we see the result of the is the complex frequency plane, and every dot therein represents an identified frequency omega k through my Prony analysis. And the different colors represent the time window when this frequency was identified once I shifted the time window towards later times. So if I have all the blue time windows would range from 0 to 10 and up to the red time windows, and corresponding frequencies would be identified in the time interval from 10 to 20 for the time signal of my retarded two-point function. And yeah, exactly this result has to be contrasted to my analytic expectations that I introduced to you before, namely that we only have a set of decaying poles in the critical case analytically, which indeed can be identified as this red dot on the purely decaying imaginary axis, and as a more fuzzy structure at the second decaying pole in the lower half plane of the complex frequency omega. So actually what this picture shows that this Prony method indeed allows to match our numerical result to our analytic expression, which is represented in this picture here. And on top of that, you always have to keep in mind that we are considering a finite lattice system. So what we also have is our branch cut in the UV, which is approximated by my Prony method as this set of a nearly vertical set of poles at the corresponding UV scale of my lattice. So that is the result, how Prony analyzes, how Prony analyzes or represents my signal in the complex frequency plane. So what actually this method does is more than a standard Fourier transform, because we also can identify complex frequencies by this method. And similarly, if I turn on a transverse mass, then one sees also here the different representations of my branch cut. Either for small mass, the branch cut is stretching between plus and minus 2 mH, or one only has, as in this white picture, for large mass, the which would correspond to my blue representation of the analytic structure, where this branch cut is represented by this like half circle in the lower half plane between the UV lattice scale and my branch cut, my branch point at twice the free fermionness. And let's remember that a branch cut locations are arbitrary. So here I have represented this blue branch cut horizontally, but it is identical to this half circle representation as Prony identifies this branch cut in this white picture. Okay, that is like the method that we use. And now I want to apply this method to the integrable quantum field theory limit. So I want to extract in the quantum field theory regime the position of the complex frequencies of my retarded two-point function and match it to our analytic expectations in a more quantitative way. So for that MPS simulation, I have chosen some particular value of the transverse perturbation beta times MH. And we don't have any longitudinal perturbations. And I choose a set of increasing values of beta in units of J, which corresponds to going to the quantum field theory limit, which would be for beta times J to infinity. How the pictures look similarly to the case I have just shown them to you. Namely, I apply the Prodi method in the left row to the free fermion integral, which is analytically. So the integral is analytically, and I apply my Prodi method to this signal to study the robustness of my method of this Prodi analysis to see how it matches the analytic result. And similarly, I apply this Prodi method on the MPS tensor network calculation on the right-hand side. And this is shown for two temperatures, beta equals 8, and then beta equals 32, which would be a very low temperature near the ground state in the lower or in the second row. And what one can see is that one can identify the first decaying pole always very accurately, and partially also the second decaying pole. And what is also apparent that for the tensor network simulation in the right column, then for the case of the highest value of beta, then one has some more spurious effects if one compares this to the Prodi analysis that is applied to the free fermion integral, which shows that in the MPS tensor network calculation, some more numerical truncation results come into play, and in particular our limited time window that results in a more fuzzy structure of our Prodi analysis. But these pictures then allow me to study the complex frequency structure, and now I'm interested to do this more quantitatively by extracting the pole position of the first decaying pole, which is also sometimes called the first transient, which means that it has a decaying effect on my correlation function. And I do that by, in a more detailed way, by plotting the pole of this first transient in dependence on the time window. So I only show now all pole locations in dependence on the time window for the first transient. And an example of such a calculation is shown in the upper plot here, where the position in the lower complex frequency plane of this first transient is shown in dependence on the time window, or simply or in dependence on the time for each trotter step. And what one sees at early times, the result is more fuzzy, which is because at early times, there are contributions from a lot of decaying poles that overlap with each other. And at later times, these contributions decayed and the signal stabilizes. And I then take the mean value and its standard deviation for only the late time windows to extract the position of this decaying transient. And I do exactly the same also for the second part of the information, namely not only the position of this complex frequency, but also its corresponding coefficient or residue that is the second part of the information in my Prodi analysis. So by multiplying it with the inverse time or decaying time dependence, I can extract also the residue of my decaying transient pole. And the result of this procedure is shown here. I show to you the position of the first decaying transient, so the imaginary part of the first decaying transient, dependence on lattice spacing values beta times j, where going to the right side. So for increasing values of beta times j means going to the continuum limit. The blue dots here in the first set of poles represent my first decaying transient, and similarly the upper set of poles corresponds to the uncertainty that I extracted in this way for the second decaying transient. And this is done for the doing this Prony analysis for the free fermion integral as well as our MPS simulation. And what these plots show that my numerical procedure allows a very good agreement with the analytic result, which would be the dash gray dashed line, which would be the analytic position of the first decaying transient. And similarly, for the first decaying transient, this is very accurately. It is very in very good agreement with the analytic position, and at least partially also the second pole can be identified. And we also see that our MPS result is nearly identical to the free fermion calculation. So that shows that our MPS simulation allows for a nearly identical good quality of our signal that we simulate with our tensor network. However, one important information is missing, namely the residue of our first decaying transient in this continuum limit. And actually, the position of the decaying pole is identical for the spin chain case and the quantum field theory case. So actually what differentiates these two cases is the value of the residue, which has to match the CFT or quantum field theory prediction. And then this is shown in these two pictures. Namely, I show the value of the residue shown in units of beta in dependence on beta times j for the critical case with analytic result minus 2. And as we see, the blue dots represent my Prony result for the free fermion calculations. And similarly, as before, green dots bars represent my MPS simulation. What this shows is that for increasing beta times j, the Prony result matches or comes close to the analytic result from the CFT prediction. And actually, this gives us confidence that our numerical result actually also agrees with the or lies in the quantum field theory regime of our spin chain. And this then I can contrast to the right picture, where I'm not at the critical point anymore, but also have a finite transverse mass mh. So beta time mh has some finite value. And then the analytic result shifts from the case at criticality, which would be this dashed line to in the left picture. So the dashed line in the right picture is now for the case of a finite transverse perturbation. And actually what we see, if I do either the Prony analysis for the free fermion case or for the MPS case, is that my numerical results actually differ from my results at criticality, so that although the results do not match perfectly my analytic expectation, they clearly are sensitive to our finite transverse perturbation, that actually our tensor network simulations and in combination with this Prony signal analysis can allow for a reliable extraction of the quantum field theory part of our signal. Okay, so this part was for the integrable case where we actually know the result and we can test our method. And now the interesting part is, of course, for making predictions in the non-integrable case, which I do for the ferromagnetic and also for the paramagnetic case. I have chosen some finite values of the transverse perturbation. Now choose a set of increasing values of longitudinal perturbations, beta times mj. And for all the cases of different temperatures, beta times j, that are shown in this plot, the result of the position of the first decaying pole is shown in the ferromagnetic and also in the paramagnetic phase of a very complicatedly interacting non-integrable quantum field theory for this Ising model. And what all these plots show is that the result of the position of the first decaying transient is actually consistent with the case, or seems to be consistent with the result of the integrable case. So with the case at criticality, with the first decaying pole is located at minus one in the lower frequency plane, if I rescale with beta over two pi. So the effect, or there seems to be no effect of the longitudinal perturbation to my quantum field theory. The first decaying transient seems to be consistent with my result at criticality. That is the prediction we make from our tensor network simulations on which we apply our Prony signal analysis. And we can also make statements for residues, but let me skip this part. So yeah, this what I have said so far was referring to the first decaying transient, so a decaying effect on my retarded two-point function. But in the beginning, I also told you that there's a second part of possible effects in my or contribution to my retarded two-point function, and that are meson states that appear as non-perturbative bound states in non-integrable in the non-integrable regime of my quantum field theory. And actually these in the case of the E8 quantum field theory of Zamolodchnikov, these particle masses or meson particle masses are analytically known. There are eight particles, and the ratio of these particles M2 to M7 over M1 are analytically known and are shown in this table here. So what is shown here is the ratio of these masses from 1 to 7. The last one is not included. And what we do similarly, we can extract the corresponding frequency with our Prony analysis. And actually what this table shows here, that our Prony result compared to our analytic result agrees actually quite amazingly with the analytic prediction. So actually what this shows that we can expect with this Prony signal analysis that is applied on our tensor network simulation, extremely non-trivial results of these non-perturbative and non-integrable bound states that appear in the quantum field theory regime of this E8 quantum field theory case. And this looks like this, namely these bound states are in general not or maybe decaying or not decaying. So if they are not decaying, we are talking about effects that appear on the real axis on the complex frequency plane. So previously I was talking about the imaginary part of the complex frequency plane. Now I concentrate of features near the real axis on the complex frequency plane. And this is shown in these two plots here for an example of parameters, once in the ferromagnetic and once in the paramagnetic phase. So we here actually, I show a result of Prony analysis applied to our matrix product simulation for a very low temperature that is close to the ground state. And what these stable poles near the real axis represent the values of the values of these meson states that have been studied previously by some truncated conformal space approach by Zamolodchnikov and collaborators. And we masses of these bound states M1 to M7 are numerically known up to some precision by these works I have shown here. And actually what this picture shows that we can reliably actually identify with our matrix product state simulation, these meson bound states form our tensor network result. And so you see here exactly on the real axis three stable mesons. And then we also have further meson states that are labeled M4 and M5 here. And we even can zoom into this into these in more detail. And what is then shown here that these slow a tiny bit off in the complex frequency plane, and the ratio of this imaginary part or their decaying behavior of these meson states matches actually a prediction by Delfino and collaborators. So what this shows that we can extract extremely non-trivial quantum field theory results from our real-time signal that we performed with our matrix product state simulation, which can be applied for the ferromagnetic case and also for the paramagnetic case, which are not symmetric because the quantum field theory is not identical, but in the similarly we can identify two meson states M1 and 2 in the paramagnetic case. And what we can also identify in both cases is actually the continuum threshold at 2 M1, so twice the mass of the first meson state, which is denoted by this dashed line in the left picture, and similarly by this dashed line in the right picture, which is visible as a set of these fuzzy set of poles in the lower complex frequency plane. And that is actually also a feature or a non-trivial result or property of my quantum many-body system in the quantum field theory regime. What is only a lattice effect is this boundary excitation that we also see at very low frequencies, but that we can also match with the DMRG calculations. So what I have shown so far is, as I think, are really actually amazing non-trivial properties of my meson states of a very complicated interacting quantum field theory, which is non-integrable. We can match these results that were previously done for the vacuum phase at very low temperature. Now we can also heat up our system, and I can make predictions at higher temperature for my quantum many-body system in the quantum field theory regime. And that is shown in these two pictures. Namely, the left-hand picture is identically the same to what I have shown you just a moment ago. Now I show you the complex frequency plane in units of mg, that remember was the mass scale in the longitudinal direction of my Ising or my perturbed Ising quantum field theory. And this is a very low temperature, where on the right-hand side, I have the system heated up to a higher temperature. And actually what appears as a difference is that on the right-hand picture, additional mass differences appear in my complex frequency plane. Namely, the mass difference between the second and the third meson state, or for example, also the first and second and other ones, which seem to be a clear effect of heating up the system. So we make the prediction that at finer temperature, the frequency structure of my retarded two-point function changes for this interacting and non-integrable quantum field theory that we are considering. So that's a clear prediction that we can make with these tensor network studies. And finally, let me also mention that we, of course, can also simultaneously can study the transient, so the decaying effects and these meson states in the quantum field theory regime, namely in this picture for some values of the perturbation. I show you now the full complex frequency plane, where I can identify the first decaying transient pole at position minus one for the imaginary part of the complex frequency. And similarly, I can also, with some accuracy, can also identify the first and second meson state of my quantum field theory that match numerical predictions from the conformal truncated space approach. And what is a clear quantum field theory effect are these meson states. And simultaneously, we can identify also the decaying pole. So actually what this shows is that we, or that also our decaying pole seems to be a quantum field theory contribution to my signal. Okay, that was a lot of information. So let me summarize to you what are the key features of the points that I have presented to you. So what I wanted to present to you is that tensor network techniques actually can be used to extract very non-trivial real-time thermal field theory dynamics. And what we needed for that are only pretty intermediate time scales. So tensor network simulations are limited by the growth of entanglement, and the results I've presented to you needed only pretty intermediate time scales. And what maybe was new to you or to a lot of people is this Prony method that I wanted to introduce to you, which is a method that allows to numerically evaluate the structure of functions. So in particular, the retarded two-point function in my example, in the complex frequency plane. And the result of my tensor network simulations agreed with the CFT result, or the free Fermion quantum field theory, in the case that the system was integrable. And what I also discussed with you that I could make, or that I could match meson masses for the perturbed Ising quantum field theory near the ground state. And we also made predictions for the thermal behavior at a finite temperature in the quantum field theory regime. On the other hand, there was also a prediction for the movement of the first decaying transient in the non-integrable regime, namely that the pole doesn't seem to move by doing perturbations. So what could be future directions, namely, but I want to emphasize that so far I only considered zero momentum calculations, but of course we can do the same also at finite momentum, which might change the frequency structure. This is doable by the tensor network simulations, and this is one direction. And we can also study features that appear in quantum field theory. Namely, things like meson melting at high temperature could be, in principle, things that can be studied also with tensor network setups. But also coarse-grained systems, which go in the direction of quantum simulations or higher dimensional setups, could, in principle, be studied with these tensor network simulations. So what I actually want to convey with this points is that very rich of complicated setups can be studied with tensor networks. And I have presented to you a first study of real-time quantum field theory dynamics, which already allowed us to study very non-trivial systems. So with this, thank you for your attention. And please, if you have further questions, then ask them.
So guys, you have any questions?
Hi, this is Rakib. I have one question.
Hello.
Do you hear me, Johannes?
Yes, hello. Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, so the question is, can this sort of techniques be used in realistic theories like QCD?
Yes, so QCD like Schwinger model or even QCD were put on a one-dimensional spin chain. And can be studied also with tensor networks. In this sense, one can study also richer spin chain setups with the limitation to one plus one dimensional systems.
I see. So you cannot use it for a QCD in three plus one dimensions.
I mean, there are already first studies with these PEPS tensor networks in two dimensional, even in real time simulations. There are, but these are limited to very early or small time scales. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, there's at least a toy model for a contraction of the three-dimensional tensor networks. So at least some toy models already go in the direction of three-dimensional systems. But studying full QCD in three plus one-dimensional systems would be certainly a dream, but we are still far away from that. But
how about supersymmetric Young Mills, like maximally supersymmetric SUN in four dimensions? These theories are integrable, and they seem more manageable to me from this regard.
So what one needs is simply a Hamiltonian formulation of my system, and so right now the problem is more dimensionality. So so already two dimension is still hard computationally, mostly because of doing the contractions that appear in my tensor network, and then also doing things like real-time simulations. So although there may be higher dimensional system might be somewhat easier or constrained, simply going to these higher dimensions is a huge challenge, and right now not it's not doable in three or in three dimensions. Although maybe the sim model itself might be simple, that it's still not possible.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions, guys? You have anybody can ask whatever you want. Rothindro, you have any question? Nitin?
No, sir. No. Actually, I was just thinking, I mean, this is not directly related to this, but I was thinking that the results that he showed for the safety, I mean, those results for the theoretical, they have been derived using the Virasoro algebra. Or something else, like some other field theory. I mean, two dimensional safety results.
So the as long as the system is integrable, so at least for the at criticality, for the Ising CFT, the results are fixed by conformal symmetry. For the case of the transverse perturbation, when we have only transverse field turned on. We can map it to free fermions. We can also study it, but even for the E8 case, that we have purely longitudinal perturbations, it is integrable. But at least for this retarded two-point function, the retarded two-point function was actually not calculated. So even although the system is integrable, it's not known if or no. Analytic expression for this particular quantity is known, but at least then what is the gain of all these tensor network study is to actually go beyond this integrable regime, which contains, for example, these meson bound states, and actually these tensor network studies with matrix product states in particular then even allow to actually extract this part of the information from our tensor network signal.
Okay. Nitin, do you have any question?
Yeah, sorry, I had a little...
No, sir.
Kaushik? Kaushik, can you be able to hear me? Do you have any question?
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, no, sir. Like, actually, hello.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Well,
we can hear you. Probably there is some problem in his end. Jitendra? Okay, I think Shattoki, do you have any question?
No, sir.
Abhinash?
Not really.
Abhinash?
No, sir. Thank you. It is a nice talk, though.
So, I think nobody have any question. So we are very thankful to Johannes to give us such a nice and clear talk. And after this talk, we will be uploaded. It is in the YouTube. So
one more thing, can I just ask? Yeah. So I just wanted to know this for the case of quantum field theory or quantum gravity. Just quantum gravity. For the case of quantum gravity, how can we use this? I mean, this is mainly great way of doing some computational results, and I mean getting the computational results using this using the simulations using this method. So for the case of quantum gravity, can we use this?
So what here
tell my question.
Is done really a quantum many body system, and then the quantum field theory part of the underlying continuum description. Maybe if you mean quantum gravity, you probably mean like geometric interpretation of tensor networks. And yes. So that totally doesn't play any role here. What is a different line of research would be like to associate a geometry to some tensor network, like the Mera tensor network, which looks hyperbolic. Mm-hmm. So of course there is a lot of interest to think about this in the context of ADS-CFT. But exactly. This is or doesn't play a role for at least this particular simulation, because what we really need is a matrix product state representation of my state. And this I can time evolve without any ideas or more of like from this quantum many-body perspective, independently from any interpretations from quantum gravity.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. I mean, this is not directly related to this topic. I just asked as it is one of the fields where this method can be used.
Shubhashishda, do you have any question? Shubhashishda, can you able to hear me? Do you have any question?
Well, if there are no
Hi. Thank you for this very nice and instructive talk. I just was wondering on this outlook part. You mentioned something about coarse-grained systems for quantum simulations. So can you elaborate on that a little bit, just as a passing? I don't want to take too much of your time.
So what I have used in the simulations that I have shown to you were systems of maybe about 100 to 200 spins. What would be interesting is to get the same kind of information from the quantum field theory out of it for smaller systems of maybe 10, 20 spins, which at least in principle could be also maybe studied experimentally on some quantum simulators. I mean, with cold atoms or whatever, people can do amazing things. And this would be really nice to have a method for that. And actually in a follow-up project, we are looking into this right now by maybe seeing if we can employ some Mera tensors for my continuum description. And the idea is one idea is that maybe we could get the same kind of information for small out of that for even smaller system. So that could be also experimentally relevant.
Okay. Yeah, that would be very relevant if that can be done. Yeah.
It certainly would be very, yeah, nice in a way.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Jenly, you have any question?
Not really. It's an interesting talk. But you know, I'm far, a little far away the topic. But anyway, it's a very good presentation and enjoy it. Thank you so much.
Jitendra, do you have any question? So I think nobody have any question left. So we all thank Johannes to give such a nice and clear talk, and we will come up with many, many talks in near future. So see you guys again.
Thanks a lot to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the organization.
Bye.
Take care. Bye. Bye.